Good morning, church. Glad to see you. Where's everybody at this morning? Amen. Say, we're here, right? Amen. All right, fishing. Why didn't they take me with them? What's going on? No, it's all good. Hey, just a few announcements this morning. Just Dan's Fish Rides coming up right around the corner, May 18th. So if you have tickets that need to be sold or money that needs to be turned in, see Miss Justine. It's still not too late to grab a sign and throw in your yard and help promote that and get it going. So once again, a reminder, it's just going to be a drive-through this year again. So right now, which was a real successful thing for us last year. So hopefully it goes well again for us. If you're interested in helping, thank you to those who have signed up. But we can always use the more hands, the better it's going to be on everybody else. So if you want to be a part of that, just sign up or let me know what you want to do. And then come and eat with us too. So that'd be fun. Another reminder, the weather pushed our parking lot back a little bit. The rain that there's a little bit of rain we got last week. So they're planning on coming Tuesday to do this section of the driveway. So Tuesday and Wednesday, they'll be doing this section of the parking lot. So just to kind of let you be aware of that, if you plan on coming here for something, make sure you use the east parking lot, okay? Weather permitting, hopefully it doesn't get pushed back again. Just another reminder, the car show. It's such an exciting thing that we're going to be putting on this year, and we're super thrilled to do it and nervous too. So please take some flyers. There's some flyers out there. If you know anyone with a car or just people that love to come to car shows, just let them know about that. It's going to be an awesome time, and it's going to be a great opportunity for us too, because that car show is to really kick off and promote our Vacation Bible School. And Emily's working real hard on that, and it's going to be such an awesome car mechanic theme. It's going to be really fun. And at the end of the car show, or during the car show, our church is going to be decorated with the VBS stuff. So people in our community and you yourself are going to be able to come through and see what's about to take place the following week, starting on Tuesday, right, for VBS. So, and that the VBS times is what again? In the evening? 6 to 8, something in that ballpark. So yeah, so that's going to be a fun time as well. And we need helpers. So if you want to come and help with kids, we really need you to help with that too. Mother's Daughter Banquet, the money's due today to purchase a ticket. See Miss Justine if you need any information on that or a ticket. Saturday, May 8th, so that's next Saturday at 10:30 a.m. Come and look forward to have just a fantastic time with that too. And then one last reminder real quick, Memorial Day carnations. So if you are interested in having a Memorial Day carnation, we're going to decorate the stage somewhere up here with those for Memorial Day, to be in remembrance of those that have served and have fallen. And so we just want you to be able to do that, and it'll be a fun time. So those are $1.50 a piece, and you can see Miss Justine with that too, okay? Can we all stand and greet somebody, and let's get ready to worship the Lord.
Well, good morning. You see the sun out there today? You know, when I drive to church on Sunday morning, this is my time. That's my time. And sometimes it's raining, sometimes it's not. But when it's a sunny day like today, I'm driving down 69, and the sun is on this side. And it gets warmer and warmer. And by the time I turn on 469, it's right in my face. And today, I didn't even put the visor down, because I take that as a personal blessing for me. So I get to come here and praise the Lord, and in our meager way, give it back to him. So we are up here and you're down there, but actually we are down there and you were up here, because we're all doing this together. So let's praise the Lord, all right?
Thanks to the Lord, our God and King, his love endures forever. For he is good, he is above all things, his love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise. With a mighty hand and outstretched arm, his love endures forever. For the life that's been reborn. His love endures forever. Sing praise. Sing praise. Sing praise. Sing praise. Forever God is faithful. Forever God is strong. Forever God is with us. Forever. From the rising to the setting sun, his love endures forever. By the grace of God, we will carry on. His love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise, sing praise, sing praise. Forever God is faithful, forever God is strong, forever God is with us, forever. Forever God is faithful. Forever God is strong. Forever God is with us. Forever, forever, Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show the way. From the earth to the cross, my debt to pay. From the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky, Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show the way. From the earth to the cross, my debt to pay. From the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky, Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I lift your name on high.
You may be seated. Heavenly Father, thank you for the sun this morning. Thank you for your blessings. Thank you for this church, Lord. It's really a pleasure and a privilege to be here. In Jesus' name, amen.
It is the cry of my heart to follow you. It is the cry of my heart to be close to you. It is the cry of my heart to follow all of the days of my life. It is the cry of my heart to follow you. It is the cry of my heart to be close to you. It is the cry of my heart to follow all of the days of my life. Teach me your holy ways, O Lord, so I can walk in your truth. Teach me your holy ways, O Lord, and make me wholly devoted to you. It is the cry of my heart to follow you. It is the cry of my heart to be close to you. It is the cry of my heart to follow all of the days of my life. Open my eyes so I can see the wonderful things that you do. Open my heart up more and more and make me wholly devoted to you. It is the cry of my heart to follow you. It is the cry of my heart to be close to you. It is the cry of my heart to follow all of the days of my life. All of the days of my life. All of the days of my life. All of the days of my life.
Can the ushers come forward, please? As they're coming, I want to also just, make a short little thank you to the church. And I know we talked a little bit about it at the turn of the year, but I mean, I don't know how much you know of what goes on behind the scenes at the church, but thanks to your faithful giving, I cannot begin to tell you what God has done through that giving, the things that we've been able to continue to do here at the church. To do ministry, to keep the doors open, to fix the parking lots, to change lights out, to do all the different things we're doing, to clean the carpets, to keep the building fresh, to be a good steward of what God's given us to do, to be able to continue to do and to plan children's ministries and to fix things when they begin to break. And like I said, just continue to be a good steward of what God's given us and to be able to help people. And I just want to say, as your pastor, from the bottom of my heart, thank you. It's pretty impressive to see what God can do through the faithful giving of his people. And as you know, through COVID, we've lost some numbers, but our giving has gone up. Praise the Lord. Amen. Give the Lord a hand on that, because it's through Christ that we're able to continue to succeed in the kingdom. And I just want to say from the bottom of my heart, thank you for your giving. And with that in mind, let's pray for our giving and our offering. Jesus, we thank you so much for the faithful giving of your saints, Lord. And we pray that you continue just to open the floodgates and to bless those that are giving, God. And Lord, I just pray that if there's anyone here today, Lord, that's on the fence about what that looks like in their life, that obedience, God, I just pray that you just pour into them that your love, Lord, and that what Scripture teaches about that you love a cheerful giver. And I just pray that that people are truly, truly blessed when they give, God, because we can truly trust and know that you're going to take it and multiply it and do something far beyond our human capabilities with it. And we just thank you so much for what we're watching and experiencing you do in our fellowship. And we thank you so much for what we're about to receive today. And we pray that in Jesus' holy name. Amen. Amen.
Psalm 145, 18. The Lord is near to all who call on him, to all who call on him in strength. How wonderful it is to know that he is near. And don't we all call on him now, today? Doesn't that bring us so much peace? When the peace of Christ rules our heart, gratitude overflows. Even in the darkest of times, we can praise God for his love and his promise to be near us when we call. Jesus Christ, I think upon your sacrifice, you became nothing, poured out to death. Many times I've wondered at your gift of life, and I'm in that place once again. I'm in that place once again. Jesus Christ, I think upon your sacrifice, you became nothing, poured out to death. Many times I've wondered at your gift of life, and I'm in that place once again. I'm in that place once again. And once again I look upon the cross where you died. I'm humbled by your mercy and I'm broken inside. I thank you. Once again, I pour out my life. Now you are exalted to the highest place, King of the heavens, where one day I'll bow. But for now, I marvel at this saving grace, and I'm full of praise once again. I'm full of praise once again. And once again I look upon the cross where you died. I'm humbled by your mercy and I'm broken inside. Once again I thank you. Once again, I pour out my life. Thank you for the cross. Thank you for the cross. Thank you for the cross, my friend. Thank you for the cross. Thank you for the cross. Thank you for the cross, my friend. Thank you for the cross. Thank you for the cross. Thank you for the cross, my friend. Thank you for the cross. Thank you for the cross. Thank you for the cross, my friend. And once again I look upon the cross where you died. I'm humbled by your mercy and I'm broken inside. Once again I thank you. Once again I pour out my life.
Dear Lord, thank you for your peace that transcends understanding and your love that endures forever. Even your very love transcends understanding. Thank you for the cross. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Thank you. You know, before I dismiss the kids, I just want to say two quick things. You want to know one of the most sweetest things in the world is how our young ones, you know, pick up some of these songs and they start singing them. And just our little Roman's been on such a kick of singing lately. And we were driving home from worship practice Thursday, and I didn't show this to them yet. And I'm just driving home and I hear him in the back, thank you for the cross. Thank you. It's just amazing. I hear it. And then a couple weeks ago when we sang Death Was Arrested, he got the words a little mixed up, but he's like, Jesus was arrested, you know, but in heart, he knew what he was singing. So children, you are dismissed. As they're leaving, hey, one announcement I did forget to mention. If anyone here likes to paint, raise your hand. Okay. Not pictures, walls. Okay. We are going to be painting this back wall here very soon. I've got the paint already. I just need to go get some rollers. If you're interested in painting, see me after service. I'd love to actually put a date down where we can start working on it. A lot of times we just say, who wants to help? And then it never gets planned. So if you're interested in helping, please see me because I could use your help because we want to get this back wall painted. So, huh? Plan first. That's right. That's right. Turn with me in your Bibles this morning to Matthew chapter 5, verse 1 through 12. I do not have the full scripture on the screen this morning. And I don't have a page number for you, so I will tell you it's the first book in the New Testament if you have a Bible in front of you. Matthew chapter 5. This is a really interesting story, part of the Bible, and we'll kind of get into that. This is the beginning of the Sermon on the Mount, and you'll hear me talk a little bit about it today. This is a sermon, the beginning of a sermon, a three-chapter sermon that Jesus Christ himself preached, and it's an amazing, amazing time. And just another, you're probably sick of me talking about my time in Israel. Maybe you are, maybe you're not. But I remember, if you ever want to be just totally taken back, I remember being with my mentor, Mark, and we're on the side of the mountain where it's believed that this took place. And Mark, from memory, from heart, recites this three-chapter sermon. And it was just breathtaking just to look out on the side of this mountain and just see all this and to take this in. It was amazing. But if you have your Bibles with me, can we do something a little different this morning? Can we stand? Can we do that as we read God's word? I don't like it when pastor makes us do stuff different. So, all right. Verse 1, chapter 5, it reads like this. Now when Jesus saw the crowds, he went up on a mountainside and sat down. His disciples came to him, and he began to teach them. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people insult you, persecute you, and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Rejoice and be glad, because great is your reward in heaven. For in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you. Father, we thank you for this word this morning. May this powerful message you've given me today just saturate our minds and our hearts. And may we apply it to our lives, God. And may today we take away what it is that you have for us. And I pray that in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. So there was this mother and daughter that were on their way home from church on a Sunday morning, and the little girl turned to her mother and she said, "Mommy, there's something about the preacher's message this morning that I just don't understand." And the mom said, "Okay, what is it?" And the little girl replied, and she said, "Well, the preacher man said that God is bigger than we are." And the mother said, "God is bigger than we." Or sorry, the little girl said, "Well." He said that God is bigger than we are, and he said that God is so big that he could hold the whole world in his hand. Is that true? And the mother replied, "Yes, honey, that's true." And she said, "But Mom, he also said that God comes to live inside us when we believe in Jesus as our Savior. Is that true too?" And the mother again, she assured the little girl, and she said what the pastor said was true. And then with a puzzled, childlike faith look on her face, the little girl asked, "If God is bigger than us and he lives inside of us, won't he show through?" Isn't that such an amazing thought? And this morning we're going to be looking at the beginning of this Sermon on the Mount, and we're going to be looking at the what is called the Beatitudes, because that's exactly what the Beatitudes are. The Beatitudes are God showing through us. And it has always been, I believe, God's purpose that as he entered our lives, that he would show through, that he would be visible in all our attitudes and all our actions, not just Sunday. We hear that all the time, right? Not just Sunday and Wednesday, but all the time. And you know, it's not that we would imitate Christ, even though the scripture tells us to, like Paul says in 1 Corinthians 11:1, imitate me as I imitate Christ. We're told to imitate Christ, but it's more than that. It's not that we would just try to play like Simon Says with Jesus and just do what he says, but that Christ himself would be allowed to live through us. If he's in us, we would allow him to live through us. And see, the Beatitudes, this idea that we just read, these things, that these nine different things Jesus talked about, these blessings are like a light bulb inside of us that only shines, these actions, these attitudes, they only shine when we're plugged in to the power of God, to the Holy Spirit, amen? Because that is the power of God in us. And so we must know that these aren't just acts. You know, one preacher noted that the Beatitudes, they're supposed to be your attitude. Isn't that neat how that kind of works out, right? It means that you can't pretend. You can't just fake it till you make it and put the smile on. Like, these are the things that must shine in the life of a believer. Because here's the thing, humans, you know, we're fallible people. We mess up. We make mistakes. We deal with anger on a daily basis. We deal with lust on a daily basis. We deal with addiction on a daily basis. We can't do it in our own strength. But by the power of the Holy Spirit, He has come to live in us that He might live through us, that He might shine through us. And when He does, this is the cool part about it, church. When He does, we are fulfilling our call. It means that other people get to see the image of Christ shining through our veil of flesh, however dirty it may be, you know? And so let me ask you a question. I'm glad we got some kids in here this morning. How would life be different if Jesus came and took your place right where you're at, right? Adults, what if Jesus came and He took your place in the home, right? Let's say He took over as the man of the house or the woman of the house. What would that look like, right? What if he went to your job and performed your work on the job and probably showed you up because He's going to be better at it, I guarantee you, right? What if Jesus did that? Kids, what if Jesus came and He took your place at your desk at school Monday? You're probably thinking, yeah, is He going to do the homework too, right? No, you get straight A's, right? You better, right? But how about this? Let's turn it in on myself. What if Jesus came and He took my pulpit, His pulpit? What if He took my place? How awesome and yet terrifying would that be, you know? Oh, man, this is exactly what Jesus wants to do, though. I know it sounds elementary, but it's what He wants. See, Jesus came to live within us so that He could, this is going to sound a little preachery, okay? Just follow me. A new word, put it in Scrabble. He came to mortify the carnal works of our body, meaning the works that were from the very beginning, our carnal nature, like our sin nature. He came to mortify them. He came to master the circumstances of my life, the good and the bad, to teach us how to control and how to react to bad situations and how to react to good. And you may be thinking, well, what's a bad way to react to good? Well, boasting, right, is a way to react negatively to good things. He came to manifest His character, not your character. Right? And He came, this is the beautiful part, He came, His whole purpose, and when He's in our lives, is to minister to others whom our lives touch every day. And knowing that makes me ask the question, the tough self-examination question, does anyone ever see God show through me? Maybe not all the time, probably not all the time, but does anyone ever see God show through me? And if they did, they would know exactly what He looks like because these Beatitudes I just read are a portrait of Christ. I mean, just look at it. When we look at Jesus and we begin to align these up, He was poor in spirit. You know, although He was the Almighty God with all rights and privileges and deity, what does Scripture say? We were just talking about it through Isaiah all this time in Philippians, that He made Himself of what? Of no reputation. He didn't come down to be recognized. He came down to serve, not be served, right? He took upon Himself the form of a servant we've been reading about. And He was made in the likeness of men. And He humbled Himself and became obedient to death, even death on a cross. See, He was poor in spirit. He emptied Himself. Jesus, we know from Scripture that He mourned. He wept for His friend Lazarus, right? He looked over the city of Jerusalem and broken, knowing what was to come and to befall this city, and He wept. He was a man of sorrows, Scripture says. He was acquainted with grief, Scripture says. We know Jesus was meek. We know He thirsted and hungered for righteousness. We know He was merciful, and I could go on and fill out every single one of these. Because if you measure the life of Jesus Christ by these qualities, the Beatitudes, you'll find that He modeled every single one of them, every single one of them. And so I'm convinced that this is not a description of man, of a Christian man, but of the God-man Christ. He shined while He was on this earth, bright. And now that He's gone, He can live in us, through us, in the Holy Spirit, so that we can shine as we surrender our lives to Him. And so here's the question, why do we study this today? Why? It's because the very first word in verse 3, blessed. And so Jesus gets our attention right from the beginning. He grabs it because Raise the hands. Who in here wants to be blessed? Right? Well, let me say, something else might get your attention too. What if it said cursed? Would that get your attention? Yeah. But he says blessed. And so here's number one. You can fill it out in your bulletins. I want to share with you two things this morning. What people will see when God shows through. Number one, they'll see a happy person. And I know sometimes that can seem kind of weird when we talk about the Bible. We don't want to talk about happiness. But let me explain. Because like I said, this is the first sermon Jesus ever preached. And he begins with this promise of happiness. Nine times you heard me read, blessed is this, blessed is that, blessed is this. Nine different times Jesus reached out to the multitudes on this hill. And what's so important about that is because these are people that are much like us today, maybe even a worse situation, but these are people who were oppressed politically. They were oppressed socially and economically. And what does Jesus do? He's talking to this rugged bunch of group that's just the downcast of society. And what does he do? He offers them genuine joy. You see, we got to get into these Greek studies sometimes. You know how I am. And the Greek word that is translated blessed here is makarios. Can you say that? That's an easy one. Makarios. You can roll the R if you want. Makarios. Okay? And so it means happy or blessed. But here's the thing. When we look at it in the biblical times, it helps shed some light on it because it was typically used to describe the wealthy. Why? Well, because they had the money to do what they wanted to do, right? They were happy. It was this idea that money could buy happiness. There's still that idea today. It was used to describe the Greek gods because they had the power to gratify all the selfish desires of their flesh. It was used to describe the state of contentment and delight that was usually reserved for the very privileged minority. And so because of that, when we begin to look at the context of this verse and we see blessed, we kind of see their idea and their definition of what happiness was. And, you know, not just they, but ours today. And so it might look something like this if we were reading it today in a worldly view would be blessed are the rich or blessed are the famous, right? Or blessed are the gifted or blessed are the powerful, right? But how many people do you know that have everything in the world are not happy? Right? How many people do you know? Maybe some of us in here, we have things. We're doing well in life, but there's just something deep down inside you that's just like, I'm not happy. Happiness is such a common desire. Wouldn't you say? Who doesn't want to be happy? Raise your hand. Okay. All right. See me after church. We got some talking to do. Everyone, that's a common desire. But so few people actually are. More people, I would say, just from experience, even with myself, have more of an appearance of happiness than true happiness. It's that they fake it till they make it. So when we look at this idea that blessed are the rich and the famous and all these different things, the problem with that is that if happiness is linked with power, not everyone's going to have it. If happiness is linked with prosperity, meaning having money and good wealth, I sure ain't going to have it. A lot of people ain't going to have it. You know, I feel very blessed for what God's given me, but I'm talking big, big dollar money, right? This prosperity, everything you do is good for you, right? A lot of people ain't going to have it. If happiness is linked with popularity, not everyone was going to have it. If I was popular, if we were popular, we'd have seats in the back room out there, right? Not everyone's going to have it. I don't know if you know who Chuck Swindoll is. Sometimes he's on the radio. But he wrote on WBCL and some other places. But he wrote a book called Simple Faith. And he was talking about this very passage of Scripture. And he made this following observation that I'm about to share with you. And he noted that Jesus used, well, I've already said, these nine back-to-back statements of blessing. And he remarked, this is what he said. He said, he's talking about these people on the mountainside. He said, having endured a lifetime of verbal assaults by the scribes and Pharisees, the multitude on the mount must have thought they had died and gone to heaven. I mean, if someone showed up today and told you and looked at you in your sadness and depression and said, blessed are you, what would you think, you know? If someone stood up to you while you're mourning in grief of whatever the situation, and we'll dig into that deeper later, but, and he said, blessed are you, what would you think? And if you think it's true, then you would think, yeah, I've died and gone to heaven because I don't know how I can be happy. I don't know how. And so here's the thing. A lot of times, people look at the Bible and they look at it through the wrong lens, and they look at the Bible and all they can see is the negative. They look at the Bible and they look at Scripture and they emphasize all the rules and the prohibitions and the curses and the judgments and they leave people, when they talk about this, they leave other people that are impressionable with this impression that God has this disposition of an angry school principal, right? They seem to see God as this cosmic killjoy who spends his time trying to think up of a new way to make you miserable, right? Jesus painted a different picture, didn't he? He showed them a God who wanted them to have joy. He showed them a God that, despite the junk that's going to happen in this life, he said, there's something greater to come, and I want you to be joyful and live in anticipation for what's to come. He wanted to fill our lives with satisfaction, contentment, and delight. Contentment's a big thing. Contentment's a hard thing to grasp. The same word blessed is used in 1 Timothy 1:1 in New King James. It says, according to the glorious gospel of the blessed God, which was committed to my trust. So if that word blessed could mean happy, check it out. I'm so happy and so glad that we serve a happy God, right? A happy, joyful God. Yeah, God's going to bring his wrath down at one time, but for the most part, I don't think he has that disposition of a dill pickle, right? I don't think he has this angry disposition. And so here's what I want to say this morning. Don't let anyone ever criticize you for having fun at church, right? Don't let anyone ever criticize you, or don't feel bad about yourself if you wake up tomorrow and feel like you had a good time at church. Like, this has to be such a serious thing at all times. If going to church is dorky and boring, then you can just slap the label on me right now. I'm okay with it. I love church. I love being with y'all. The same word is used in Titus 2:13. It says, look for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God and Savior Jesus Christ. So if this could also mean happy, it says looking for that blessed hope. It means that I have this, that I'm happy. Why? Because I know he's coming. But some of us just look at it's the end of the world. And we live in fear, right? We see the negative. Remember I say some people look at the Bible and they see the negative? We need to look for the positive, and we need to be like, yes, Jesus is coming back, and that's a good thing. It means everything wrong is going to be made right. Every knee is going to bow. Every tongue is going to confess. Jesus Christ is Lord. Amen, right? What else does Revelation say? No more pain, no more sorrow, no more tears, no more nothing. Everything's going to be made perfect again. If hair ain't standing up on your neck this morning, I don't know. That's exciting. Here's another thing that doesn't sound so good. That word also has a third meaning. It also means fortunate. So when we go back and we read, and let's change the word blessed to say fortunate are the poor in spirit. That doesn't sound very good, does it? So I want to just say this morning, congratulations. And if you're poor in spirit, congratulations. If you're mourning, congratulations. I mean, that's kind of what Scripture's saying. I mean, it means that you've been chosen to share in some of the sufferings in his life, in this life, with Jesus Christ. And but here's the thing. We know there's going to be trouble in this world coming our way. John 16:33 tells us that. Many other passages do. But here's the turning point in our life as Christians. Are we really going to see those things as negatives and allow ourselves, allow our circumstances, allow our troubles, allow our situations to define us and trap us in that current state, physical or mental state of mind? Or are we going to rise above it? Are we going to let Jesus shine through us and let his mind be in you and be your attitude, right? 1 Corinthians 2:16 says that we have the mind of Christ. Are you happy, church? And today, so many people spend their lives thinking, man, I'd be happy if I had this or if I had that or if this would happen, or if that would happen. And they're looking for happiness in all the wrong places. They're associating happiness with all the wrong things. And the sad part is they'll never have enough. Because when God truly shines through, the world will not only see a happy person. Why? And it almost sound like I'm going to contradict myself here a little bit, but because happiness is often, in the worldly side of things, is often just based on happenstance and circumstance. But Jesus is saying, it's okay. It's okay to be poor in spirit. Blessed are you. Blessed are you. You know, when we're living like that, it's because we're living underneath the power of the Holy Spirit that's revealing things in our life. That's why you're poor in spirit. It's the consciousness of Christ that lives in you that if it wasn't there, you probably wouldn't be poor in spirit. If it wasn't in you, you probably wouldn't mourn, right? And I keep wanting to talk about that mourn, but I got to wait to get to it in my message because it doesn't mean maybe what you're thinking this morning. So when God shows through, we'll see something different. Number two, not only will we see a happy person, we'll see a whole person. Like I said, the Beatitudes is this portrait of Christ, that we would see God. If he was living in every believer, we would see him. You know, that's God's purpose. Romans 8:29 says that for every Christian, and he wants every Christian to be conformed into the image of Christ. That's sanctification. That's us being made into the image of Christ, this continued process in our life where we're being transformed daily into the image of Christ. And I think it's so reasonable to draw these conclusions then, is that the Beatitudes must describe the qualities of every Christian. That every Christian should exhibit it. Not that it's some class of super Christians with these superpowers, but that every Christian should exhibit all of those traits. They are not guidelines for just Christian character, because a guideline suggests a standard that you and I should live up to. But we don't have what it takes to live to that standard set by the Beatitudes. Instead, what do we have? We have sin. We have sin in our lives. We're born into it. And it's that original sin that must be cleansed. See, sin at work in the heart of people makes us proud. Sin in the work of the heart of people makes us pushy. And it's the presence of sin that produces a hunger and thirst for things that are unholy, things of this world, not righteousness. See, sin is not... We see all these bad things that are happening in our world, abortions and murders and all these different things that are happening in our world, and we think that sin's the problem. I want you to know, sin itself is a spiritual problem, and it requires a spiritual solution. And these Beatitudes, they describe the evidence of someone's life that is yielded to Christ. They are not produced by the Christian. It's not things that we do, but it's things that are produced in the Christian, right? It's things that they tell us what people will see in a life that's surrendered to Jesus. The Beatitudes, they don't represent these individual one-by-one qualities, but a complete picture of a sanctified life in God, a complete package, a whole person. The Bible in Galatians 5:22 talks about the fruit of the Spirit, right? It's not talking about the fruits of the Spirit. You need to understand that clear distinction. It's talking about the fruit of the Spirit. It's nine different things as one. And a person under the control of the Holy Spirit isn't going to demonstrate love but lack self-control, right? The evidence of a person that is truly walking in the Spirit is that they exhibit the fruit of the Spirit on a consistent, not perfect basis. Does anyone know what they are? Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. There's a cool song about that from grade school, from elementary school. The Beatitudes are the same as those fruits. And so the question is, are we seeing God work in a person's life if they're poor in spirit, but yet they still hunger and thirst for the world? Will God make me weak, but yet allow me to lack purity. No, he won't. I mean, what kind of God would that be? If he worked that way, God doesn't do things halfway. And, you know, if we are saved and filled with the Spirit, then these fruits, these attitudes, they're going to shine through us. And I would say this morning that it's impossible to genuinely display one of these qualities as a work of God without displaying them all. And, you know, and that sounds extreme, but it's so true that because of circumstances, one or more of these at times will be more prominent. There's times where I may not show a whole lot of kindness, but it doesn't mean I don't show it at all, right? There may be some times I might not be so gentle in certain situations, but not completely lacking it. It's very possible. But I don't think the Holy Spirit will manifest one with a disregard to another. I really don't. Because if that's the case, I think it's a sure sign that what we're seeing is a fleshly counterfeit, not a genuine spiritual work of God. I gave you this next quote in your bulletins. It says that the Beatitudes are not a standard for me to achieve, but a yardstick by which to measure my submission to the Holy Spirit. So that means, this is the good part about it. I'm giving you lots of information this morning, but you know what it means? It means you don't have to worry about whether you are poor in spirit. You don't have to check these off like a box. You don't have to worry about if you're meek. You don't have to worry about if you're merciful. You don't got to worry about that. Your focus should just be walking in the Spirit, being submissive to the Holy Spirit when the Holy Spirit calls you to something. Because I know that if the Holy Spirit is in control of my life, I got nothing to worry about. He's going to manifest those things. He's going to manifest it through me, and God's going to show through me. However, these Beatitudes, though, they do let me know if I'm being hateful and vindictive, then it's a sure sign that I'm not walking in the Spirit. Maybe I'm dealing with an unforgiving heart like we talked about a little bit last week, or maybe I'm dealing with anger and judgment and all these different things we talked about Wednesday night, and I'm dealing with all these things. Maybe it's a good sign that I'm not walking completely in step with the Spirit. Because if I'm driven by self-ambition, then my life has not yielded to Christ. If you have your Bibles open, I'm going to look at just verse 3, 4, and 5, and then we'll close. I want to explain some of these. Verse 3 says that they're poor in spirit. What that means is that there's an emptiness. This means it's about ourselves. Because, church, some Christians, they go all about as if with an ego. Like, and that means like how I want to feel about me, or reputation, what others say about me. But as Christians, we should strive to be about character, what God knows about me. Church, we all want to feel good about ourselves, but biblically, you can, this is going to hurt, but you cannot feel good about yourself until you feel bad about yourself. Ouch. That does not feel good. It doesn't sound like what the world teaches today, does it? Seeing ourselves accurately comes by seeing the Lord in all his glory. Let's look at three examples from the Bible. Isaiah saw the Lord. What did he say? Woe is me. Peter saw the Lord. And what did he say? He said, depart from me, I'm a sinful man. Paul, who was once Saul, as he was Saul, he ran into Jesus, had this amazing encounter with him on the road to Damascus, and was physically blinded, but spiritually he could finally see for the first time. And he was saved. And it was all when he became poor in spirit. That's what that means. He was emptying himself away from his own ego, his own ideas, or the worry or care about what those of you think next to you. And he just followed the Spirit. Verse 4 says, blessed are those who mourn. This church, this is a brokenness. This isn't necessarily, and I do believe that God's with us when we mourn for those that we love that have lost and died and passed away. I do believe that, okay? But what this is talking about, and you can look it up in anything at all, but it's talking about our sin. What it's saying, he's saying, blessed are those that realize and that their hearts break over their sin. And that they realize that it breaks God's heart. And so theirs breaks over it too. Number 5, verse 5, is meek. And this is one that we struggle with today. Because this is submissiveness. This is about our Savior. This is about power under control. This was Jesus. He could have snapped his fingers and made it all go away. He could have erased all the beating. He could have pulled himself off the cross. He could have done all those things the devil wanted him to do in the desert in Matthew chapter 4. He could have done all those things just to prove his power. It's power under control. If any of you have ever been around a horse or worked with horses, it's that picture of a horse that's been broken. A horse is so powerful. Is that horse weak once it's broken? No, it's not. Why? Because meekness is not weakness. It's being under the control of God. I want to invite the worship team to come back up. Some of us need to understand that as Christians. We lack that state of meekness where, and we lack that state of poor in spirit too, where we just get comfortable with our sin and we do nothing about it. And we lack the meekness to do something about it. And you know, I want to say that, you know, the happiest people in the world, I think, are those who yield themselves to the experience of the Spirit of God in their lives every day. I know some of the poorest people who have nothing that are some of the happiest people in the world go to work at the Rescue Mission of the Salvation Army, and you'll see it. Men who have nothing, and they're some of the happiest people in the world. I know people in the church that don't have a lot, but they're the happiest people in the world. They have genuine Christ-filled joy because in Christ we have everything we need. Why is that so? Why are these people the happiest they can be when they walk in the Spirit of God? Well, the Bible, take it straight from the Bible. It says that it's because theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Because they are comforted. Because they will inherit the earth. Because they are filled. Because they obtain mercy. Because they will see God and others will see God shine through them. Because they are called children of God. And so God says, Jesus says, blessed are you. I know you're sad. I know you're dealing with some things. I know it's hard to humble yourself and to step out and to admit when you're wrong and to confess your sin and to ask for forgiveness. But he said, blessed are you. You know why? Because you're going to heaven. He says, yours is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when you are stricken and the Holy Spirit pricks your heart and you respond to it and you mourn over that thing. Why? Because yours is the kingdom of heaven. When you mourn, you will be comforted. It's because God makes them a complete person. Can we bow our heads and close our eyes this morning? I want to ask us to use our imaginations a little bit this morning. Right now, with your eyes closed, I want you to, it's going to sound a little silly, but I want you to reach into your hip pocket, and I want you to pull out a little mirror, all right? Just imagine it. And I want you to look into that mirror. What do you see? What do you see? Church, are we removing ourselves and allowing God to so control and fill our lives that he shines through? You know what he looks like. His portrait is in the Beatitudes. And if when we look in this spiritual mirror and we don't see Jesus, if we're seeing maybe a dark secret that we're holding on to, if we're seeing anger and jealousy and rage and whatever it may be this morning, if we're seeing that instead of Christ, or if we're just focusing on how good we look, why not take the first step and yield yourself to the Holy Spirit today? It's not the only way that you can experience these qualities, or it is the only way that you can experience these qualities of a happy, joy-filled blessedness that goes along with these, is when we surrender ourselves to Christ. And so as we sing our last song, I want you to, in just a moment, once they start singing, I want you to open your eyes and I want you to really look into that imaginary mirror that you're holding. And I want you to respond if the Holy Spirit's calling you to. In any way, whatever that way is, respond. These altars are always open for you to come and to pray about whatever is troubling you. These altars are always open. If you're sitting there this morning and God's doing some good things in your life and you're filled with joy and you just need to get it out, come down here and smile and laugh and just feel the warmth of Jesus. And if you're struggling with some things right now, whatever it may be, come to the foot of the cross, come to the altars, and just leave this place refreshed. Leave this place knowing that it's been nailed to the cross, that Jesus has got your back. Let's sing the song. You can open your eyes.
Over the mountains and the sea, your river runs with love for me, and I will open up my heart and let the healer set me free. I'm happy to be in the truth, and I will daily lift my hands, for I will always sing. But when your love came down, I could sing of your love forever. 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 Over the mountains and the sea, your river runs with love for me, and I will open up my heart and let the healer set me free. I'm happy to be in the truth, and I will daily lift my hands, for I will always sing of when your love came down. I could sing of your love forever. 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 Oh, I feel like dancing. It's foolishness, I know. But when the world has seen the light, they will dance with joy like we're dancing now. I could sing of your love forever. 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 I could sing of your love forever.
I'd say that song really evokes the spirit of me of what we've been talking about this morning. To have such a joy-filled life, no matter what you're going through. I know some of you are going through a lot. I know some of you have a lot on your plate. But the Lord loves you. And the Lord is there to carry you through every single step of the way, no matter what it is. Don't dismiss whatever your problem is as being too little or too great, because He can handle it all. Amen? Let me pray. Father, we thank you for this message this morning. God, we just pray that we can do everything we can in our power to walk in the Spirit. And I just pray that as we do, Lord, just shine through us, God. Lord, use us as a vessel, as a tool, whatever it wants, whatever we want to call it, for your light. And Lord, I just pray that verse of Matthew 5:16, may we let our light shine before others, that way they can see our good deeds and praise our Father in heaven, God. And we just know that that light that's shining is you every step of the way. So Lord, I pray that you encourage each and every one of us, strengthen each and every one of us, and give us a spirit not of fear, Lord, because that's not what we have. Give us a courageous spirit to walk through this life, daily and to share Christ with others. I pray that in Jesus' name. Amen. You are dismissed, church.